sports has ever known. NASCAR has arrived to the city that is the crossroads of America.
Well, we're here.
This is Gasoline Alley,
the Brickyard. I can't believe I'm here.
Captain it.
Won it.
Doing it.
We're ready.
Hey, I'll see you in Victory Lane.
And here's what will await the man who crosses the final yard of bricks ahead of all others. He will forever be known as the first to win the Brickyard 400.
Come on in. Speedweek is next.
At Indianapolis Raceway Park for this edition of Speedweek. A big racing evening here at IRP. Later tonight, Thursday Thunder and the Silver Crown cars from USAC. Hi everyone, I'm Bob Jenkins, and it is a big racing weekend or end of the week here in the capital of motorsports. We of course have the big Indy 500 on Memorial Day weekend and the U.S. National NHRA drag races here at IRP on Labor Day, but this Brickyard 400 three or four days is a big event here in the Indianapolis area. I'm very glad to be joined tonight by the man who is Thursday Thunder. Dave Despain has joined us, and thank you very much for helping out.
Always a pleasure to share the Speedweek chair. You talk about ESPN being all over this big weekend. Check this guy's schedule. Qualifying today, here for Speedweek, then off to NASCAR World. Tomorrow, qualifying show live. Tomorrow night, live preview for the Brickyard 400, and Saturday, the race itself. I know you're whipped. I know you're busy. I want to help you out here. Take care of you a little bit. I got 30 pounds of notes
great.
There.
Just so exactly what I need.
Gets. That'll
Thank
go
you.
With the 130 you've already read. There's a clean
good.
Shirt in there. You won't have time
I do
to
need
change.
That, yeah.
You didn't have time for dinner. Let me help you out with
Thank
something
you.
Good to eat there. That's nourishing. You may want that.
Did you bring the ketchup?
No ketchup. You
okay.
won't need it. They're delightful. And we ordered you an oxygen bottle. Think you'd be all huffy and puffy when you got here, but you're in great shape. Let's have some fun.
Well, it has been a great day, and it all began at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway about 9:30 this morning when they opened the track for practice. Then some rain, but they got it dry in time for qualifying. We'll check out how a few of the good guys did. Dale Earnhardt. Now, Brett Bodine was on the pole at this time with a speed of 170.084. Now, Dale Earnhardt's speeds are compared to Brett's. Brett's are in yellow. Earnhardt's are in white. So you can see that Dale was on a very good lap. He was faster than Brett all the way around, but was it going to be good enough to knock Brett off the provisional pole?
A lot of straightaway speed here. I can't help but recall that Earnhardt drove the last couple of races at Ontario Motor Speedway, the clone of this place. Great teams produce great results. This was a good run.
It really was, and it was indeed good enough for the pole position. Brett Bodine was knocked off, so at the moment, Dale Earnhardt was on the pole, and you're right. There are a few selected drivers who have raced in Ontario, and that's got to give them at least a slight advantage over the rest of the guys because this is a completely new racetrack to most of them.
And they're all learning, and one measure of greatness is how quickly you learn.
That's for sure. Now, Rick Mast, who is one of the Hoosier drivers, was out to qualify. And, well, I don't know whether you would call this a surprise or not, but he sure did a great job out there. Rick Mast, who has won pole position at Atlanta in November of 1992, look how his straightaway speed compared to Earnhardt's. It was 2 miles an hour slower, but in the corners, he was much faster, 4 miles an hour faster through the short chute and 2 miles an hour faster in turn two.
One of the guys they really feared through testing here. This car showed a lot of speed, and Mast kept the speed through the rain delay today that washed out a lot of the final tune-up practice session when they really could have set the cars for qualifying. Mast kept his speed.
And Rick Mast brought the car through corner number four and onto the main straightaway. The checkered flag was awaiting him, and indeed he did knock Dale Earnhardt off the pole position with a speed in excess of 172 miles an hour. Now, Hoosier tires are made just up the road from Indianapolis near South Bend, Indiana, and I know that they want more than anything else to bring home a victory for the Brickyard 400. They're halfway home with the pole position.
Motivation. It's all over this place. Everybody wants to win this race so bad, and I think Bob Newton's at the top of that list.
I think you're right. Ernie Irvin, how about it? He is the Winston Cup points leader going into this event. His trap speed at the end of the front straightaway was a couple of miles an hour faster than Ernie Irvin, but again, look at through the corners and into the short chute. He was 5 miles an hour slower than Rick Mast in the south short chute, and a 4 miles an hour slower through corner number two.
Qualifying and racing are always two very different things. I sense that here, that gap will be even greater. Everybody wanted to be on the pole today, but winning the race is the big issue, and I wonder how much these guys might have been focused on race setup.
And so Ernie Irvin did qualify, but it wasn't quite good enough to knock Rick Mast off the pole position. Ernie with a 169.453 mile an hour lap, and so at that point in the afternoon, Rick Mast had the pole position, but there were still a lot more drivers to qualify, and we will check on how several of them did when we come back on this live edition of Speed Week from Indianapolis Raceway Park. Stay with us.
Speed Week is brought to you by Bridgestone, the next revolution in tires.
Earlier this week, Kiers Pollack of PPG Industries presented to the Indianapolis Motor Speedway the Brickyard 400 PPG Trophy. 51 small bricks at the base will carry the name and winning average speed of each victor. In keeping with the tradition of the Indianapolis 500 BorgWarner Trophy, the PPG Trophy will be permanently on display at the Hall of Fame Museum. The winning driver will receive a $200,000 cash prize from PPG, and along with his car owner, a sterling silver brick, emblematic of their Brickyard 400 history-making victory. Welcome back to this live edition of Speed Week from Indianapolis Raceway Park, where a nice crowd is on hand to see the USAC Silver Crown cars run tonight. And Dave Despain and Gary and Larry will be here with all the action on Thursday Thunder in, what, about an hour and 20 minutes from now?
Under an hour.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, let's find out what else happened at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway today as we resume our coverage of pole day qualifying for the inaugural Brickyard 400. Now, here is Morgan Shepherd in the Citgo Ford owned by the Wood Brothers. And we documented, of course, during our coverage today how the Wood Brothers came here in 1965 at the request of Ford Motor Company to help Jimmy Clark in the Indianapolis 500. They contributed to Clark's victory. Morgan Shepherd down the straightaway quite a bit slower than the pole sitter Rick Mast at that time. His cornering speeds were also a little bit slower than Rick Mast, but nevertheless, Morgan was doing a great job out there.
He sat in fourth in the qualifying order for a long time. It looked like it might hold up, and then bam, 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 we get a rapid-fire series of better runs, and they dropped him all the way back to 11th qualifying spot.
Nevertheless, Morgan Shepherd is one of those drivers who you can always count on to do well in the race. He has finished in the top of the point standings for the last several years. Never makes a whole lot of headlines. You don't hear him winning a whole lot of races, but he's a very consistent driver and finishes up in the points nearly every year.
I'd take him as a dark horse to win Saturday, absolutely.
You're darn right. Now, let's get back to the Hoosier tire story. Remember, at this time, Rick Mast is on the pole running on Hoosiers, but the guy who more or less carries the Hoosier tire banner, or has so far this year, the only winner of a NASCAR Winston Cup race on Hoosier tires is this man, Jeff Bodine.
A lot of people expected similarities here in terms of car setup and so forth with Pocono, where he won so handily and gave Hoosier their first victory. Bodine, again, one of the cars, one of the drivers, one of the teams that they feared coming in here, and he had a pretty good run going.
He sure did. Now, of course, the speed he was shooting for was in excess of 172 miles an hour, but it was pretty obvious as he made his way through the north end of the racetrack between turns 3 and 4 that the speed was going to fall a little bit short of what it was going to take to get on the pole position. Bodine took the checkered flag and qualified at 170.982 miles an hour, and that will put him fourth on the grid for Sunday's race. And, of course, now the top 20 today
today are locked into those positions. Everybody else has the option to stand on their time or qualify in second round tomorrow. And we go now to a guy who we know is not going to, because he's solidly in the top 20, and that is Jeff Gordon. Talk about a hometown favorite. This guy, after coming here from California, settled down in Pittsboro, Indiana, not too far from here, to gain some experience in sprint cars and midgets with the United States Auto Club on the dirt tracks and the short ovals here in this area. Choosing to go to NASCAR Winston Cup Racing, he's recorded a victory this year at Charlotte Motor Speedway. This would be definitely the crowd pleaser on Saturday to win.
All the Thunderheads are so proud of this guy. What impresses me, I think, is the way he's been accepted in the NASCAR fraternity. He's kept his head on straight for a kid this young. I mean, think about the average age of NASCAR drivers and think about what this young man has accomplished. Boy, it is some kind of a future, isn't it?
And you know, one reason why he's been so accepted so quickly into stock car racing is because they know he is good, and he is, if not now, one of the superstars of years ahead. Jeff Gordon qualifying for third position there. You can see the front row will be occupied by Rick Mast and Dale Earnhardt. The second row, Jeff Gordon and Jeff Bodine.
Top four qualifiers followed by Bobby Labonte and Bill Elliott in row three. Brett Bodine and Ricky Rudd in row four.
In the fifth row will be Sterling Marlin and Mark Martin. And in row number six, there's Morgan Shepherd with a 169.6 and Rusty Wallace with also a 169.6.
Seventh row has Greg Sachs, 169.6, and Dale Jarrett. And then Michael Waltrip and Dave Marcus, who had a good qualifying run, to 16th starting spot.
In the ninth row will be Ernie Irvin and Jeff Brabham. There's one of the guys who is a non-regular on the Winston Cup Series, who will be in the ninth row, and Rich Bickle and Hut Strickland complete the top 20 qualifiers at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway today. Well, one member of Dale Earnhardt's team, Chocolate Myers, his family has been around stock car racing for generations. He serves well as the gas man on Earnhardt's car, but in recent weeks he's become a media star on ESPN2.
This is Chocolate Myers, ace reporter for ESPN2. We're going to give you a tour of RCR racing like you've never seen before. Okay, here we are at the office. Let's go to work.
Debbie, thanks for the helicopter ride. Send the bill to Dale.
You got it.
I'm going to tell you folks about all the different types of motors we have here at RCR. This here, this one right here, Chevy V8. This one, Chevy V8. This one, Chevy V8. This one, Chevy V8. This one, Chevy V8. That's all you need to know.
Did you know I was doing TV instead of working?
Shocked that you do a lot of things when you're not working, so it doesn't surprise me.
I do a lot of things when I'm supposed to be working.
Nobody can cross these barriers.
I work here. I do what I want to do. Come on, guys. These machines here are... These are a couple of big machines we have, and actually they don't let me come back here too much, but they're big machines.
What are you doing? Don't you have some bathrooms to clean? What are you doing?
TV, man, TV, doing TV. Mister, can't you read the sign, do not touch? We let you in here, we didn't tell you could play with everything we have. This is a transporter here at RCR. A lot of people see this truck going down the highway, see the outside of it. I'm gonna carry you somewhere. You people get to go. We come in here and watch ESPN, ESPN2. Benny Parsons can't get up here. But since I'm an ace reporter for ESPN2, I can just about go anywhere I want to. Hey, there's nothing to see here. Get back. Let's disperse. Okay, this looks like one of the qualifying engines they're building. I wonder if they got any secrets in it. Let's see. Oh, yeah, looks like they've got a lot of stuff in this engine. How you doing? Chocolate Myers from Welcome, North Carolina. Special investigator for RCR. Heard someone's been selling secrets to the enemy. Could it be either one of you guys?
I don't think so.
How about you, sir?
Chocolate Myers, could you tell me the difference between a restricted plate flow and normal flow of a carburetor?
I'll have to get an expert opinion on this. I should have known the answer to that one myself. Let me show you a few of the benefits on working on the championship team. This is a benefit, this is a benefit, this is a benefit,
I've got some more benefits at home. It's been a long day. Hope you've enjoyed your tour of RCR shops. Be looking for me at the racetrack. I'll be the one putting the gas in Dale's car. This is Chocolate Myers, ace reporter for ESPN2.
Benny Parsons, look out. Your job may be in jeopardy. A new media mogul is on the scene in Chocolate Myers. We're at Indianapolis Raceway Park for this live edition of Speed Week, and we'll be right back. Welcome back to Speed Week on ESPN. This live edition from Indianapolis Raceway Park. We are about 40 minutes away from Thursday Thunder, and tonight it features the USAC Silver Crown cars in a 100-lap event, and it should be an absolutely outstanding evening of racing. We hope you'll stick around and join Dave and Gary and Larry for all the action at 8:30 Eastern Time. Now, joining Dave and me here in our little broadcast position is the guy who is currently the points leader in the Silver Crown Series, but who also won the championship, back in the early 70s? And you're still hanging around? Here's George Snyder.
I'm still here, and it's been a long time ago, too, and it's getting tougher. These young kids are giving us all we can do to keep up with them, I'll tell you.
How'd you do in qualifying tonight?
We didn't do very good. We had a little malfunction in the gear department, and the gears went upside down, and we lost like a second or more when we qualified. But we'll come back in the heat race, I think, and we should be all right.
I want to jump in there and elaborate a little bit on that item about the young kids, because we got Kenny Irwin Jr. tied with you for the championship point lead, and I'm thinking Kenny Irwin Jr. probably wasn't born when you won that 1971 championship, and I'm wondering how you managed to whoop on guys that young at your age. I'm not going to ask you how old. How do you do that anyway?
Well, I don't know, Dave. I really enjoy driving these cars, and as long as I'm competitive driving them, I'll just keep driving them, you know, but they're tough. And Kenny's got a real good team. He drives for Dave Calderwood, and Dave's out of my hometown, and I have to go over and work on Dave's car sometime to help him out, but it's worth it. Dave's good people. He kind of helps me out, too, but all these young guys are great. You know, Bliss, Tony Stewart, all these guys, they're all tough.
They used to call these USAC Championship dirt cars, but they don't anymore because they compete on the pavement quite regularly. Is that something that you prefer over dirt, or are you still one of those guys who likes to get out there and sling the mud?
Man, I'm still from the old school. I like to sling the mud, but you got to do what you got to do, you know. I mean, if there's one on pavement, you got to just do what you can do, you know, and hope it comes out all right.
I want to ask you about this weekend. There's so much excitement surrounding the Brickyard, and your old buddy got back in the race car today. Did you give AJ any pointers to help him in his qualifying attempt over there for the 400?
No, I didn't really give him any pointers, but I think he'll still do all right. I think he'll make the race, but I haven't talked to him since he did his thing today. I don't know if they ran short on practice time with him or really what, you know, but he's got a good car, and he's supposed to have pretty decent motors. The motors are coming out of Rusty's shop, from what I understand, so I think tomorrow he should do all right. I don't know, like I said, I wasn't there, so I don't know if the weather affected when he went out or what, you know, but I think he can still make the race without a problem.
Well, he's 45th fastest at this point, so obviously he's going to have to go through second day qualifying. He's got an uphill job, but as you say, if anybody can get it done, A.J. Foy can. How does tonight look for you?
Well, I think we'll be all right. Like I say, we had a little problem with the gears and stuff, but we ran a little bit more than a second faster when we was out here warming up today. I mean, we got nobody to blame but ourselves. It's just one of those things that happened. So I think we'll be all right, you know. At least I hope so. All we can do is one of them deals. All you can do is hope, you know.
All right. Well, we shall see when action begins here before too long at Indianapolis Raceway Park. It is, as you can see, beginning to rain here. Just a few raindrops coming down. Let's check out how they qualified for tonight. P.J. Jones, the quickest at over 118 miles an hour. We'll be back with more live Speed Week after this. Back at Indianapolis Raceway Park for Speed Week, here is how they qualified for the Kroger 200 Busch Grand National Race, which will be held here at IRP tomorrow. And, of course, that will be televised live here on ESPN. They're the top 10 qualifiers for tomorrow night's
Kroger 200. Excuse the umbrella, but it is beginning to rain here. Not very much, but it is coming down. Hopefully it'll go away and we will be able to show you some racing tonight. Well, we continue on Speedweek tonight with our Driver of the Year journalists expressing their opinion on various things. Bob Marcus has been a reporter for the Chicago Tribune for many years and does the motorsports writing for that. And he has an opinion on what's going on here in Indianapolis this weekend.
Thanks, Bob. I'm here at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway in a week when history is being made. For the first time in its more than 80 years of existence, the world's most famous racing facility is going to be home to a second event, a stock car race. And that's a little like having a Rolling Stones concert at Carnegie Hall. But the people will come, because the people always come to auto racing in numbers that are truly astounding. You could maybe argue that traditional American sports, the so-called stick and ball sports, are more popular with American people than auto racing. Although I don't know how you can argue with numbers like 350,000 who were here last May or the 300,000 who are going to be here Saturday for the inaugural Brickyard 400. One thing I don't think you can argue with at all, and that's of all the fans in America, the ones who are most passionate about their sport are racing fans. I've covered just about every sport in the world for the Tribune, and I can tell you that no other athletes as a group are as fun to deal with and as easy to get along with as race drivers. And no athletes are as accommodating to their fans. I was having lunch the other day with Jeff Gordon, and Jeff was telling me that it wasn't so many years ago, when he was only a 12-year-old kid, that he came here to see his first Indianapolis 500. And he came away with one memory that still sticks with him, and that was of going right down there by that chain link fence and waiting for Rick Mears to come along and sign his autograph. Rick finally came and he autographed Jeff's t-shirt, and Jeff says he probably still has that t-shirt hanging in his closet today. And now, whenever a youngster approaches Jeff for an autograph, Jeff remembers that. And he says, I treat kids special because I know what kind of an impression it makes on them. I know what kind of impression racing has made on me. And in a few weeks, I'm going on to another assignment, and I won't be around the races as much as I'd like to be anymore. And I'm going to miss it a lot. And the thing I'm going to miss most are the people.
Here's a look at our CarQuest racing calendar with events coming up. For all your auto parts needs, you'll find it at CarQuest. We are back at Indianapolis Raceway Park. It's continuing to sprinkle, and I want you to know one thing now, Dave. I did not invite you on this show to be my umbrella holder.
I am proud to bear your umbrella. I want to wish Jeff Gordon happy birthday. He got third in qualifying, and he's my pick to win the race.
Next week on Speed Week, an interview with the head of FISA, Max Mosley. We leave you tonight from Indianapolis Raceway Park with an opinion on who's going to be the Ray Haroon of the Brickyard 400, who's going to win on Saturday. I'm Bob Jenkins. So long, everyone.
That's going to be John Andretti.
Dan Gordon.
Good evening, Dale Earnhardt.
Rusty Wallace, what do you think, Carol?
I'd like to see Ernie Irvin win it.
Dale Jarrett, of course.
One of Junior Johnson's cars. Who else? One of the three.
Well, we're hoping for Jeff Gordon.
Jeff Gordon.
Rusty Wallace, of course, and it's Ford. That'd be fine, Rusty Wallace.
Man's need for it is undeniable. He expresses it in the sky with thrusting jet aircraft, on the ground with screaming race cars, on water with thundering hydroplanes and magnificent sailboats. He uses power from explosive fuels, power from the wind, power from his own muscles, whatever it takes to attain the objective. that ability to go so fast that the wind literally splits before him. In these sports of raw speed, we see man's uncanny ability to become one with a machine. The art of using a tool to perfection. When it comes to out-and-out speed, nowhere can man go so fast as in the air. At the controls of his most exotic tools of speed, he's hit well over 2,000 miles per hour. But even at Mach 3.3, there's more to going fast than just kicking in the afterburners. Join us now as one of the fastest men on land, Indy 500 champion Emerson Fittipaldi, climbs into the cockpit and discovers the secrets of speed in the air.